Good morning. I guess we're going to start a minute early, aren't we? Everybody anxious today? This morning, we are so blessed to have this beautiful group of young people to lead us into worship today. Would you please be in an attitude of worship and just soak in every part of what they're going to bring to you. You guys ready? You sure? Okay.
I was feeling that breeze, singing like a song through the tall oak trees. It was just another summer night, had to be the last thing on my mind. Yeah, I was all lost in the moment, I was younger and wide open. It was just another summer night, had to be the last thing on my mind.
You were there, you heard my prayer in that broke down dusty room. It was the first time I said I'm yours, the first time I called you Lord.
When love broke through, you found me in the darkness, wandering through the desert. I was a hopeless fool, now I'm hopelessly devoted. My chains are broken.
It was late in the summer when the northeast breeze sang like a song through the tall oak trees. Pennsylvania, she kind of caught my soul, which had me a little more open than closed. Walls I built, opinions I learned, covered in the ashes of bridges I burned, blind to the arrow that was headed to my heart. But you hit the mark.
When love broke through, you found me in the darkness, wandering through the desert. I was a
Would you please pray with me? Gracious and holy God, you do find us in the desert. You do find us wandering in the darkness. And Lord, you draw us to new places. With your love and your grace and your mercy, Lord, you gather us in your presence. And gracious God, we ask that today you would be a part of every single thing in this time of worship, that you would be glorified in this space through every word, every step, every breath, every song, every interaction. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Would you please stand for our opening songs today?
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun.
falls, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you.
Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Be seated. Good morning. My name's Pastor Diane, and what a joy it is to see all of you here this morning. I understand that we have no coffee today. Am I right? Is that true? Oh, somebody has some. They brought it from home, right? Yeah. Or did you leave and go get it when you realized what was happening here? I don't know. He's not telling. I so apologize that we have no coffee today, but I'm so impressed that you're still here. Way to go, church. Way to go. Wait, what'd you say? They're going to have coffee after worship? Woohoo! Did you hear that? It's coming. It's coming. Hang on. There will be a light. You never let go. Don't let go. Yeah, there we go. Welcome to worship today. It's such a joy to have all of you here and together in this place. If you would take a few moments to look at the announcements in your bulletin, we have several things going on. We always do. Always have a lot of things happening here at the church. I encourage you to fill out these connect cards that we're putting in the bulletins, as well as to turn in your prayer concerns for us to pray over during the week. It's a great way for us to stay connected, to know who you are, and to know what's happening in your lives. I also want to call your attention to this insert in your bulletin this week. If you would first turn to this side where we have the carefully considering Christ's cup. Part on the back. We're holding these weekday worship services on Mondays at 11:15 and on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. Even if you've not come to one yet, I encourage you to come sometime and just see what's happening with this casual worship during the week. These are being led by lay leaders in our church who have been working for months on these services, and I encourage you to come and be a part of that. Child care is always provided, and everyone is welcome. And also, on the bottom of that side, you'll see there is a breakthrough prayer workshop coming. This is something that is sponsored by our Minnesota Annual Conference of the Methodist Church. We are invited to this breakthrough prayer workshop as a church that has been invited to and has accepted the call to missional church consulting initiatives. So Coon Rapids United Methodist Church is now officially an MCCI church in the United Methodist Church. You will hear more about that in the coming weeks and months, but let me tell you, it is a great honor. It says that our bishop and our conference sees us as a church with very, very high potential. Isn't that great to hear? And there, yeah. Yeah, and they're going to pour a lot of resources into our growth and into our future. And the beginning of that is this prayer workshop. So if you feel led to be a part of the beginnings of this MCCI process, Missional Church Consulting Initiative, and you want to be a part of that prayer day, you need to come see me, talk to me or Tammy about that, because we would love to take you along. There's no charge for us to go. You need to come along that day if you feel called to pray for our church in that way. On the backside of that, also on Monday, Thursday, you know how Holy Week works. There's Palm Sunday, and then there's several things through the week, Good Friday, and then Easter Sunday. On the Thursday of that week, we're going to sit and watch with Jesus for a while and hold a Monday, Thursday prayer vigil. I encourage you to read about that and then sign up online or see Tammy in the office and she can help you sign up for that. We encourage you to be a part of that. Before we continue in worship today, I do want to mention, please remember in prayer all the people in Nebraska and all of those who are dealing with flooding at this time, not to take those things lightly, agreed? Those are very difficult circumstances and seasons. Please do remember in prayer all those in our congregation and around our congregation who are sick and dealing with difficulties and job losses and all sorts of things. And prayers also for our Global United Methodist Church and our Minnesota Annual Conference as they ache and groan in the decisions and figuring out what will happen next and a way forward. And for our church right here at Coon Rapids United Methodist Church, you may have noticed that we have a few buckets sitting around. Did anybody notice that? Yes, we have living water right in our midst. Living, moving water, and you will be hearing more about our plans to deal with that by repairing major sections of our roof, actually replacing. So don't worry, we are working on it, and we are going forward with what we believe to be God's plans for a strong future for our church. Would you please pray with me over all of these things? Gracious God, we believe that our whole purpose for existence as a church is to spread your life-changing, life-giving water through your grace, through your mercy, and through your love. So, Lord, every action, every interaction, every plan, every movement, every detail of this church, Lord, we give it to you. And ask that you turn it to your strategy, that you show us how to hone every single thing we do, every single thing. Hone it for your vision, your purpose, and your strategy for this church in this community, for your glory, for the building of your kingdom in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen? Amen. If the choir would come and take their place at this time, and then once the choir is in place, the ushers will begin the offering this morning. gracious God, you give us so much. You provide us with so many things. Lord, teach us how to consistently give back to you so that we can be a part of your living on this earth and the building of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I have to tell you, it's been a little bit of a tough week, personally. I feel like I've wandered around in that wilderness that Solid Rock referred to, just a little bit, personally and spiritually. And, you know, to come here, I don't know if you guys feel the same way on Sundays, but to be with you and to hear you sing and just to be reminded again and again of God's glory and God's presence. My heart is warmed again. So thank you for what you do just by gathering. So as your pastor today, I'm thankful just to be here with you today. Does anybody agree today? It's just so good to hear you sing. It's so good to see your smiles, to hear you talk, to hear your laughter, to see your joy. It reminds me of what we are working for and what we're doing. Don't worry, I'm okay. Please pray with me. Gracious God, energize my spirit. Clear my mind of the things I worry about. Focus my heart, my vision, and my words. Focus my breath. That every single thing would be about your message today. Everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, like every good pastor preaching through the season of Lent, you know, it's this season of 40 days minus the Sundays before Easter that we celebrate together. Like every good pastor preaching through Lent, I am, of course, going to preach about plumbing. So, I know all other pastors preach about plumbing during Lent, don't they? I know they do. They must. And I've asked God, why am I preaching about plumbing? By the way, do we have any plumbers here today? Okay, good. Oh, we do? Oh, darn. Okay. So if you were here last Sunday, you know a little bit about my misadventures with my own sump pump in my house, and how God used those things and that opportunity to teach me a lot, how God stuck me at home one Wednesday for a long, long time after three accidental showers, taught me a little bit about depending on God rather than depending on my own ability to do things or not ability to do things. So we'll get back to that in a minute. We've talked at length about God's strategy, about God's plan, and how God has an organized system for moving life-giving water through this planet and through his people. How God has had this plan all along. And actually, God has a system for moving water all around this earth, a really intricate and beautiful system of moving water. Where is this? Does anybody know? Horseshoe Bend. I think it's in Utah. Am I right? Beautiful. I want to kayak around that someday. God's beautiful system of moving water and life-giving water is strategic and it's planned. And just like it moves around the earth in these ways, it moves through plants because plants have plumbing too, just like the earth does, just like our homes do, because we're trying to get water where we want it and keep water from going where we don't want it, agree? Water is important. We need it and we don't need it. And your body also has plumbing. I said I would talk about this plumbing and not the other plumbing because we don't want to talk about that. God's creation reveals order, organization, and deliberate strategy. God reveals strategy all the time. And when we step up even higher about God and look at the overarching story of the Bible, it reveals yet more strategy. You could say that the Bible has four chapters to it, really. You could say that every life has four chapters to it as well. And some of you are thinking, no way, I'm on chapter 62. That's not how this works. Four chapters in the Bible, Genesis 1 and 2, God creates us. Those are the stories in the Bible. In Genesis 3, we try to do it ourselves. I try to do lots of things myself that I should not try to do myself. Some things I should call a plumber for, and other things I should depend on God for. And actually, most things I should depend on God for. And then the rest of the Bible through now is God's all-out mission to get us back and God's mission to send us to find others so that they may find God's love and mercy and God's grace and make this world a safer place to be. And we are now, despite God's strategy, waiting for God to restore all things. We are stuck in these places now. We are stuck between trying to do things ourselves a lot and God's all-out mission to restore us, to get us back, and to put us into service to draw others back. We are in between these spaces. We've talked about this beautiful story of how God creates us in His image from dust, formed together in some strange package of muddiness. I'm a lot of mud sometimes. And how this beautiful life-giving water and the breath of God make who we are. Dust, water, and the breath of God. So today, rather than focus quite as much on the plumbing at first, I want to talk about the water. Water. Water is one of the most fantastic themes in the Bible. It's one of the best things to talk about. If you go home and Google water Bible, you'll get a ton of stuff, right? Think about it. You're baptized by water. The parting of the sea, the water. The depths of the ocean. Look, here is where it began. The water started like this. This is in Genesis 1, 2. This is two verses in. The Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And then they separate and make the sky waters and the earth water. This is where the water started. Water created by God. In Genesis 2, 6, right before humans are created, streams came up from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground. The water started like this. And the water ends like this. In the book of Revelation, where that God comes to restore all things. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. The water of life, the river, when God restores all things. This is where the water ends up. And at the very end of the Bible, it says, prophesying about our future, the Spirit and the bride say, come. The bride is the church, the bride of Christ, says, come. And let the one who hears that message, which would also be us, right, say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life. So you have this beautiful beginning of water and this amazing ending of water, where water is transferred, the gift of life, life-changing, life-giving water, transferred from one to the next, this beautiful gift. But in between, like we are stuck in the in-between, we see these. In Jeremiah 2:13, when the people of Israel were wandering around and got themselves in lots and lots of trouble, that is a big summary. Anybody have read those things? They know That's a big summary. It says, my people have committed two sins. God, this is God speaking through the prophet Jeremiah. My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water, and have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns, that cannot hold water. This is the me do it myself part. Do you hear that in these words? This is in the middle. This is the part where we're stuck also. It's in the middle of the Bible. But then Jesus says, whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a, say it with me, spring of water welling up to eternal life. Well, it turns out there's relevance to this spring of water and eternal life. And I'm not always a big history person or a big geography person, but I think it plays in here, and I think it's really important. There's this place in Israel called the Dead Sea. Has anybody ever heard of the Dead Sea? Mm-hmm. It's in the desert, and this whole area is just this wicked, awful desert. I bet some of you have been there. Has anybody been to that desert or near the Dead Sea or seen it? Yeah, nobody's admitting it right now. If you have, you know. So there's this place where Jesus walked through this desert and where the people of God walked through the desert, and it's long history in Israel, and you come up upon this place called the Dead Sea. Now, the reason the Dead Sea is so important is because it has 10 times the salt of any other body of water on the earth. So guess what? Nothing can live there. It cannot sustain any life. Therefore, it is a dead lake, a big old dead lake. Not even bacteria really grows there. It's just a big old salty dead pile of salt. And it's actually receding. And as it recedes, there's salt crystals forming. Go home and Google this, because it is cool to see the pictures, okay? The salt crystals are forming in the lake, and it's becoming deader and deader and drying up. In this Dead Sea. So here you are wandering around out in this desert, and you see this beautiful body of water, and you walk up to it and you realize, oh no, I can't drink this. It's all salt. Believe it or not, about a mile from the Dead Sea, in the middle of this funny little crag in the mountain, there is a place that has been there for a very, very long time. It's called En Gedi, and it is a spring of water. And this is believed to be what is talked about in the Psalms, Psalm 63, in a dry and weary land where there is no water, this arid land. And yet, Psalm 42, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. The fresh water that is found in this beautiful spring that just falls out of the rocks in the middle of the desert. Now, what kind of thing is that? Who expects that to happen, right? It's this beautiful, lush pocket of earth in the middle of this ridiculous land where no one should be able to live. A difficult space, and yet, there it is. This living water, as opposed to the dead water. Living water, dead water. And this was carried through in Jewish worship. They believed in living water, moving water, water that originated from the source. And this was a part of ritual purification. You know, they had to be clean in order to come to church. How many of you took a shower today? Did you take a shower? Okay, good thing, because I was going to check. No. They had to be clean to come to worship. This was a part of the purification process. I'm really oversimplifying. I know that. But it's better. Trust me, I could talk way too long. They had to be clean to come into the temple of God. And so outside of the temple, in order to make it easy, because that's what you do, they built these things called mikvahs. And they were places where the stream of water, see the little gate there? The stream of water would come in and pool there so people could stop off before coming into the temple and get themselves all clean so they could walk into the temple and be there for worship. You had to make yourself clean before you could come and worship God. There were all kinds of things you had to do before you could come and worship God, before you could even think about being in God's presence. You had to do a lot of stuff. It was a lot of requirements there. You had to earn your way in. to that space. Does everybody know about that? There was that history. So what happened over time is wealthy people started building their own private mikvahs in their homes because they didn't wash their hands with all of the grubby people standing outside the temple. So they built their own mikvahs because they were like, well, I'm going to wash myself here at my house before I go to the temple, and I just won't sin before I get to the temple, and it'll be okay. And it got to the place where the best mikvahs were really only in people's homes. So guess who could enter the temple? The rich people. And the others had to wait in line to get a chance to maybe get in. What happens when that happens? What happens then when all of a sudden you have to earn your way into the building, and it's hard to do if you don't have the means, you don't have money, you're not the right person? Doesn't it just become massively unfair all at once? But look what Jesus says. Jesus says something outrageous in that system and in that time. Outrageous! He says, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. He doesn't say, get in that cistern and get washed up and then you can come in. No, he says, he is the source of living water. He is God's grace revealed. Jesus says he's the source of living water. No more, no more cisterns. All you people who built them in your home, sorry. Your wealth doesn't matter anymore. Anyone can come. Anyone can drink from the water of life that Jesus brings. No longer would ritual bathing be required for purity. Jesus and the grace of God is how it will happen. And because of that, rivers of living water won't just flow for them, but will flow from within them. This grace of God that is available to all people, anyone, regardless of wealth, regardless of sickness, regardless of difficulty, no matter how many sins you have, this grace of God that is free for anyone now will not only flow in you and clean you and wash you, that cool, refreshing water of God, but it will flow from within you. And it will go somewhere. Oh, can you imagine that water? How beautiful that water must be in this dry and thirsty land. Anybody want that one, that water to flow from them? Probably not on you. That would hurt a little bit, right? Jesus within us is living water. It is life-changing, life-giving water that you don't have to earn. It is given for you. It is love. It is grace. It is hope. It is peace. Is this life-changing, life-giving water the source of your life? Are you tapping into that spring of living water? Really? Are you tapping into that spring? Sometimes I forget how much life there is, how much hope there is, how much peace there is, how much love there is. Do you hear the song Solid Rock sang? Love broke through. You found me in the darkness, wandering in the desert. And now I'm hopelessly devoted. Because once God's life-giving water overwhelms you with unconditional love and grace and mercy, then guess what happens? Everybody you encounter begins to get soaked. They know God's grace by your actions. They know God's unconditional love by you. They see God's life-changing water because of how you are being changed. They hear it in the way you talk, what you say, the stories you tell. God's life-changing, life-giving water. But I want to go back to that place where we get stuck. Right back here in that Jeremiah 2:13 passage, where they have committed two sins. And I want to talk about this just a little bit today. Remember, the first one is they have forsaken me, the spring of living water. This is where we forget our source. We forget. We divert our pipes, if you will. We decide we maybe could be our own source of living water. Maybe we decide that our bank account is our source of living water. Maybe we decide that our family or even our church is our source of living water. I love you guys, but honestly, it's the joy of the Lord that really wins. You see what I mean? That's what I see in you. What is the spring of living water? Be specific, because it is a very specific connection that we want to make. It is none other than Jesus Christ. It is God is our source of living water. So that first sin is they have forsaken me. Be careful where you try to draw water for your life, because I don't know about you, but this isn't appealing when you think of it that way, is it? What's the first thing you think of when you see that? I think of mosquitoes, don't you? Isn't that the first thing? Don't you love spring before the mosquitoes show up? This is just like, yes! No bugs yet. Be careful where you draw water, because if it is not God's living water, then it is dead water. Dead water has a very different property. And actually, it's deader than dead seawater, because bacteria grows in this kind of water, doesn't it? This water will make you sick. Anybody want a drink? Serious, I want you to think about it. Where is your source of strength, hope, vitality, love, acceptance, joy, peace? Where is that source? Because if it's not God, it's this. It's this. Be careful, because this is also what other people around you will encounter. If this is your source, be careful. Be careful. I want to go back to this mess too, because the second one is they have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. Well, God, I want you to be my source of water, but I'm going to engineer this relationship. I'm going to tell you how it's going to work, and we're going to design it, and I'm going to tell you what I want, and I want you to meet my needs. How's that? Is that a good idea? Please do not take that out of context, okay? Make sure you get the whole sermon in the video, not that piece, Jay, okay? You got that? Get all of it? This is what we do with God sometimes. In fact, often we do. We say, Lord, I give you my life, but then we dig our own cistern and say, Lord, fit into my plans. This is my well. Here is what I want, and here's what I desire. So you knew this is where I was going to get back to this mess, right? Did anybody wonder where I was going to get back to my own plumbing in my house? So I tried to fix this sump pump for the longest time. And I found out that if you try to fix your own sump pump and you don't know what you're doing with it, not only does it make a big mess of you personally, but it makes a big mess of your basement. And it makes a big mess outside, too, because the water that is supposed to be running away from your house is really just running down beside your house and back under your house, and so it's just circulating through your own system. I think some molecules of water may have been through my sump pump billions of times at this point. The same pieces of whatever, right? Because I don't really know what I'm doing, and I just keep recirculating things in my own house cistern until I learn to spread it out past it. When we try to do our own strategy with God, we end up with situations like this. By the way, do not Google bad plumbing. You will see things you don't want to see before lunch, okay? I know how those things work now. Does anybody know how these things work now? I know how they don't work, too. This is what happens when we try to tell God how we're going to manage our own lives and say, God, I want you to fix it, but I'm going to design it. You fix it. Or I'm going to fix it, and then I want you to make it better. We end up with leaks, and we end up with messes. We really do. Or worse, we end up with something like this, and then we find out, oh, there's something yucky in the basement. I don't really want that. Or we might end up like this. Anybody ever had that happen in their house? Or even better, we might end up just like that. Me and that guy are buddies. He's not actually my plumber, but, you know, we could be. We could be friends. Sometimes when we design our own system and ask God to just fit into it, we end up with things like this, too. Just clogged pipes with our own desires and our own demands. Our system and our life is filled up with what we think we need rather than what we really need. And instead of God's life-giving water flowing through us, we get this. And that's about it. I don't know about you, but this is the water I want. I want to be a part of that water system that moves the love and grace of God from beyond me to you, that tells you how loved you are all the time, that tells you how much grace there is for you, that tells you how much hope there is, that fills you with the joy of God's presence and peace. Don't you want to be a part of that system? I want this church to be a part of that system. I believe God wants this church to be a spring of life-giving water that wells up. Oh, can you imagine? So we need to consider our source, and we need to consider our plumbing and ask God to make corrections wherever it's needed. Wherever it's needed to surrender to the one who knows. We did this last week, and I think we're going to pray it every Sunday through Lent. If you want to say these words with me, please join me. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Because, you know, one drop of God's life-giving, life-changing water might be enough to save a life, to save someone's spirit. That's just how good it is. But what if it was more? What if we had so much of God's mercy and God's grace and God's goodness? What if it just rained down on purpose? Oh, how good that could be. How beautiful it could be. Please pray with me. Gracious God, can you make us like this? Can you make us conduits of your grace? Can you make us so full of your love, of your hope, of your mercy in this dry and dusty land? Lord, we need your water. We need your life-changing, life-giving water. We need it within us, and we need it to flow through us. We want to be a part of your system that changes this community. We want to be a part of helping others to know that they are loved so deeply, that your grace is what they need, that your mercy, that your love is all they need. Gracious God, some of us here today are so thirsty for a drink of your refreshing, life-giving water. So we reach to you today, Lord. We reach to you and we look to you for new life and new possibilities, new beginnings, new promises, new opportunities, new healing, all of these things, Lord. We look to you for that refreshing water. And Lord, some of us know we are out of alignment with you. We know we have depended on our own merit, our own worth, our own behavior to earn our keep in your kingdom. Lord, forgive us. Lord, blow up our cisterns. Teach us to depend on you completely. Lord, rain down your spirit by your grace as we pray together those words your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would you please stand for our closing song today, Grace Alone.
Every prayer and step of faith, every different
go forth from this place today completely bothered every time you see water, okay? Every time you see snow melting, every time you see water, every time you touch it with your hands, maybe you will remember God's life-changing, life-giving water meant for you by the grace of God through Jesus Christ. Go forth from this place knowing that God has a plan for you in his strategy to meet this world. Go forth to love and serve the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.